هيا على الفلاح.
Where do we stand? When we see something evil, are we tempted by it? Are we disgusted by it? Tells us how much we're remembering Allah, what the state of Iman is. If Iman is beautified, disbelief, kufr, corruption will look evil. And if shaitan has finally found an entrance, then the other way around. So Allah gave is a mercy of Allah. He gave him access to the chest, but not access to the heart. That is our responsibility. That is our responsibility. May Allah give us the ability to protect our hearts. Who is better at whisper, the human being or the jinn? Who takes the primary role? The jinn. Also, the waswasa of the jinn, huwa al-asl, as the ulama comment. It is original. In other words, if a human being is whispering something evil to you, it may or may not be his original idea. He may self have plagiarized it from a shaitan, from a jinn to begin with. But when a jinn does waswasa, it is his own. It's his original. So the source is mentioned first, min al-jinnah, and then the secondary, wan nas. And here we learn something else, vehicles. Shaitan uses vehicles. This min al-jinnah can be istikhdaman also. What that means is Iblis uses jinns and uses people to conduct his waswasa. He uses them to conduct his waswasa. So you know that waswasa of shaitan can come to you through your best friend. You hear his voice on the phone. You don't hear Iblis's voice. But you know what? At that point he's a puppet for Iblis. And he especially does this with kuffar. Not as much with Muslims, but especially with kuffar. Young man is going to college, trying to guard his shame. He's a good looking guy, you know. He decides, man, these girls give me too much attention. I gotta grow a beard. Because you grow a beard, automatic girl deterrent, right? So he grows a beard. And by the way, I'm not gonna pass a fatwa on beard, but I tell the younger guys here, if you're going to college, grow a beard. It'll save you from a lot of trouble. You're just gonna look in the mirror and say, I'm gonna go to a party looking like that. I look like I'm trying to imitate Allah's messenger, then I'm gonna go to the party. You'll be ashamed of yourself. You won't be able to go. So protect yourself, grow a beard. I'm not giving you a fatwa. This is a psychological deterrent. You know? So anyways, this guy is growing a beard. He's trying to protect himself. He keeps his eyes low. Shaitan doesn't come to him. You know what he does? He goes to this non-Muslim girl and says, hey, go talk to him. So she comes over. Did you do the assignment from last week? Innocent question. Because I think you're really smart. Uh-oh. Now it's starting to get a little dangerous. He'll come to him. And now if he starts giving it some thought, then he opened the door, now he comes to him. You see that? He'll use people like puppets to give waswasa to you. He'll use people like puppets. And now he doesn't even have to use people. Now he's got websites and TV channels that do it for him. He's got his work on DVD. You know? It just does it automated. He could kick back and relax and watch, even though he doesn't ever kick back, like we said. But we facilitated his job for him through modern, you know, mass media. Mass media can be used for great things, but for the most part, it's being used for evil things. You know, for evil things. So this is, you know, min sharril waswasil khannas, min al jinnati wan nas rather. They could be from the jinn, and they could also be from the people. But the source is al waswas. And then these are being used. So they're in a secondary position. Allah Azza wa Jal intends clearly by saying, قُلْ in the beginning of the surah, that He wants the human being to announce his weakness with his tongue. It's one thing to realize I'm weak. It's another to announce it. Now when you announce your weakness, is that an act of arrogance or humility? It's an act of humility. It's an act of declaring, I have no power, I am declaring I'm powerless, I need your protection. Now it's possible somebody needs protection, but their ego gets in the way and they don't ask. They really want it, but they don't ask because their ego gets in the way. Or even when they ask, they don't say it out loud. Can you protect me, please? Say it like under their breath. Why? Because they're too embarrassed to say it out loud. Because when they say it out loud, it exposes how weak they are. So Allah says, I want you to expose how weak you are to yourself. I want you to get rid of every ounce of arrogance there may be inside you. The word qul removes arrogance, removes from you istighna. So now listen. Allah Azza wa Jal mentions al-i'lan, the first reason for this. He says, الإعلان عن حاجته لربه ضروري من نواحي. Making this announcement of your need before Allah out loud is important for several reasons, from several perspectives. One of them, أولها فيه قتل للعجب بالنفس. In that declaration, there is the murder of you being impressed with yourself. It kills your ego when you say before Allah, I'm declaring it. This is that qul. You're saying, Allah is commanding you, say it out loud. It kills your ego. وَالشُعُورُ الْكَاذِبِ بِالْإِسْتِغْنَاءِ And your false sense of you know, I don't need any protection. You're getting that false sense of protection out of your system. وَهَذَا مِنْ أَسْبَابِ الطُّغْيَانِ. And having that false sense of protection is a kind of shirk and arrogance. Because Allah says, كَلَّا إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيَطْغَى أَرَّآهُ اسْتَغْنَى. The human being thinks he truly rebels. Does he think he doesn't have any needs? So Allah Azza wa Jalla says, declare that you have a need. Declare openly that you have a need. This will ensure your sincerity. Now you'll appreciate one more thing about why this surah is here. What was the previous surah? Ikhlas. Here's a manifestation of ikhlas. The previous surah was teaching you what does it mean to believe in Allah who is Ahad. We had a long discussion about Ahad. And to develop that sincerity before Allah. Now that sincerity manifests in you truly killing and slaughtering your own ego. That is inside the word Qul. Essentially the word Rabb necessitates the existence of an authority. You obey him because he is your Rabb. U'budu Rabbakum. You know, enslave yourselves to your master. Now, why is that important? وَالْأَمْرُ الْآخِرْ أَنَّهُ مِنْ أَسْبَابِ الطَّاعَةِ يعني هذا الإعلان من أسباب الطاعة لأنَّكَ إِذَا اسْتَعَنْتَ بِشَخْصٍ تُطِيعُهُ وَلَا تَعْصِيهِ فَكَيْفَ تَسْتَعِينُ بِهِ وَتَعْصِيهِ. How can it be that you're asking His help while disobeying Him? You can't ask Allah's help. You would never ask anybody's help while disobeying them and disregarding them at the same time. What we are learning here is if you really want Allah to protect you, what must you be doing first? You must be obeying Him. So this discussion begins with the command of Allah and you complying with that command. What that does is it necessitates in you the need to be in obedience to Allah for the protection to actually come before you. You're entering not only into the protection of Allah, but also into the obedience of Allah. I seek refuge from the evil of all creation, or everything that's been created. He said, مَا خَلَقَ, what He, subhanahu wa ta'ala, created. Why is that important? Because whatever harm the creation can cause you, know that the one who created it has more power. He can save you from that harm, because He's the one in the end who created it. So His reference, Him getting credit for being the creator, gives Him power over whatever harm the creation may be able to cause. The second is, shar is not attributed to Allah. Shar is attributed to khalq. And ulama talk about this in depth and it becomes a philosophical issue, but I'll give you the gist of it. We'll keep it really simple. The bottom line in Islamic studies when it comes to the concept of shar is that evil is not actually an entity in and of itself. It is only considered the lack of good. Just like darkness, you know the imagery of Tawheed and Shirk, darkness and light, darkness actually doesn't exist. What actually exists? Light. When you don't have light, what do you have? Darkness. So darkness in and of itself isn't an actual entity, it's goodness that's the entity, and a lack of goodness is what darkness is. So evil in the end is what? A lack of good. But this ayah has profound lessons in it because Allah left the language open and universal. مِن شَرِّ مَا خَلَقْ. He didn't reduce it to shayateen. The evil in the next surah is شَرِّ الْوَسْوَاسِ الْخَنَّاسِ, a very specific creation. But when you say مَا خَلَقَ, whatever He created, from the harm of whatever He created, we learn from this that there is no creation on the face of this earth. No creation on the face of that doesn't come without a flaw. The only one free of flaw is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything else will have something missing. Something will be missing. Some element of shar is possible from everything. Think of the most amazing creations of Allah like the sun. So many benefits from the sun. Are there harms from the sun too? So many benefits from water. Is there harm in water also? So many benefits in the earth. Are there harms in the earth too? So many benefits of the sky. Are there harms that come from the sky also? Everything Allah has created has an element. It can have harm in it. It can have harm in it. So we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to protect us from the potential harmful elements of everything. Things that are not, that are beyond our perception. You know, a car, very beneficial. Can it be harmful? Can you die in an accident? Can you get in, you know, can you put yourself in great difficulty? Yeah, it's possible. So all creations have that element of harm, potential harm in them. And so we ask Allah Azza wa Jal His protection from all of them. Min sharri ma khalaq. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. If you enjoyed this video, please do share it with friends and family. If you want to see more videos from this series, click on the box at the top. If you want to see other videos, click on the box at the bottom. And don't forget to hit the subscribe button. Thanks.